Hello and welcome everybody to a brand new chapter, module number 2, titled Special Semiconductor Devices for the subject Electronic Devices, abbreviated ED with the subject code ACC302. Once again, welcoming the entire batch of SE Electronics and Computer Science Semester 3. For this particular module number 2, the syllabus has two main units, unit number 2.1 as well as unit number 2.2. The main objective of this particular module number 2, titled Special Semiconductor Devices, is to actually introduce to the students different semiconductor devices apart from the PN junction diode, which we have already studied in module number 1, titled PN junction diode and applications. Unit number 2.1 contains the Zener diode as well as its operation as a voltage regulator, while unit number 2.2 further goes and takes different devices such as varector diode, Schottky diode, photodiode, light emitting diode and solar cells. Today, we will be focusing only on unit number 2.1, in which we will be focusing upon the Zener diode and its application as a voltage regulator. The syllabus clearly mentions that you need to only study the theoretical description, which includes the circuit diagram, the operation and working for varying DC input voltage and the varying load, along with the concepts of line and load regulation. There are no numerical examples expected from this case. So let us start our session with the title as module number 2, unit number 2.1, Zener diode as a voltage regulator. Before we go into the session, there are two main things which we need to study. The first is the Zener diode itself, and the second is the Zener diode application as a voltage regulator. First and the foremost question is, like we begin with all the sessions, why do we need a voltage regulator? Well, from the previous sessions, you also a typical rectifier along with the filter, in which you had a 230 volts AC 50 hertz line voltage being stepped down by using a step down transformer. It could be a center tap transformer or it could be an ordinary step down transformer as well. Then this particular AC input voltage was converted into pulsating DC by using a full wave rectifier circuit. Then the DC pulsations were smoothened out to give an almost constant output voltage using a filter. We had four different types of filter circuits, namely the capacitor filter, the inductor filter, the inductor capacitor filter, and the CLC, or the capacitor inductor capacitor filter, also called as the PI filter. So summing it all up, the input AC power supply of 230 volts 50 hertz is converted into pulsating DC through the process of rectification, and then the ripples, that is the AC component which is present in the output of the full wave rectifier circuit, is minimized or decreased to a great extent through the filtering action, giving an almost constant DC output voltage. That is one thing. Secondly is, since we are already getting an output DC voltage which is filtered, why do we still need voltage regulators? That's the main question. Electronic circuits, devices and gadgets cannot tolerate an unregulated DC power supply which has constant fluctuations. Their operation becomes highly erratic, and this can also result in a distorted output due to the unregulated DC power supply. The constant fluctuations in the power supply can even cause a damage to these electronic circuits, devices and gadgets. You may also have variations and fluctuations which are primarily due to the change in the load depending upon the application. Some loads may be very heavy, some loads may be light. Also, there are fluctuations due to the changes or variations in the AC mains power supply of 230 volts 50 hertz, something that is simply not in our control. Hence, the voltage regulator ensures that the load voltage at the output terminals remains almost constant despite these variations or these fluctuations brought in by the change in the load RL or the changes in the AC mains power supply of 230 volts 50 hertz. So, as we continue further with voltage regulators, the original block diagram is slightly modified like this. You of course have a 230 volts AC 50 hertz supply. You then give it to a full wave rectifier circuit. Of course, this will also include the transformer as well. The output of the full wave rectifier circuit then goes to a filter. The filter will remove any possible AC component, giving you an almost pure DC component. Now the filter output is finally given to a device called as a voltage regulator that gives you an almost constant output voltage despite the change in the load or despite the variations or the fluctuations happening in the AC mains power supply. So, the biggest advantage of simply attaching a block called as the voltage regulator to an unregulated DC power supply is that apart from minimizing the ripple component further, voltage regulators ensure that the output load voltage remains almost constant despite changes in the load RL or the AC mains supply voltage fluctuations. The performance parameters or the performance characteristics, also called as the performance specifications for voltage regulators, are of three types. One is the load regulation, called as LR. The other is the source of the or the line regulation, called as SR. And the third one is the voltage stability factor, called as SV. These three parameters or these three particular specifications actually show how good a particular power supply is. They also tell us a lot about the performance of that given power supply. Our syllabus focuses only on two main points, that is the load regulation and the source or the line regulation. Taking the first part, that is the load regulation, it is defined as the change in the output voltage VL or Vout when the load current is changed from zero, that is under no load conditions, to maximum, that is under full load conditions. It is mathematically defined as the difference between the output voltage on no load and the output voltage on full load. Ideally, the load regulation, that is LR, should be zero. However, practically, it should be as small as possible. Mathematically, the load regulation expressed in terms of a percentage can be calculated by the formula VNL minus VFL divided by VNL, the whole term multiplied by 100, where LR is nothing but the load regulation, usually expressed as a percentage. VNL is the no load voltage in volts. VFL is the full load voltage in volts. Looking at this particular mathematical expression, it becomes clear that load regulation does not have any kind of units. An alternate expression to define the load regulation would be the changes in the output or the load voltage, that is delta V out or delta VL. Now here I am using the word delta because it is the change. So delta VL can be VL2 minus VL1, or on a similar line, delta V out can be VOUT2 minus VOUT1. So this is the change in the load voltage, delta VL, to the change in the load resistance, that is delta RL, which can be RL1 minus RL2, or in short, RL2 minus RL1. Now these RL2 and RL1 are the minimum and maximum limits for the change in the load RL. So if the second alternate definition is used, delta VL upon delta RL, yes, the units now are volts per ohms. That is, what is the change in the voltage depending upon the change in the ohms. Again, this should be close to zero. However, practically, it should be as small as possible. Now, the concept of load regulation can be explained from the following. The first diagram what you see is nothing but a battery with a voltage source given by Vs. Every battery has an internal resistance given by the term small Rs. Now this forms nothing but the Thevenin's equivalent circuit. So this particular resistance Rs belongs to Vs and it is always shown to be in series. When there is no load connected, the output load voltage VL will be equal to the no load voltage VNL, which is nothing but the value for Vs. Since the current is zero due to an open circuit, the entire potential across Vs will directly appear across the output terminals. So we get two important expressions. One is VL is equal to VNL is equal to Vs. And the second expression gives IL is equal to INL is equal to zero. There is no load current. Hence, the value for the load current is actually equal to zero. So what we get is under no load conditions, there is no load current in the circuit. That is IL is equal to zero. And the load voltage is nothing but the no load voltage. That is VL is equal to VNL, which is nothing but the source voltage itself. Now, these graphs are nothing but that of an ideal voltage source, which we have all studied way back in elementary physics or in the subject BEE. Now, once the load RL is attached across the output terminals, please note that Vs, the source voltage, now divides itself across Rs and RL. So this voltage now, VL, that is the load voltage, is called as the full load voltage given by VFL. And here VFL will always be a fraction smaller than Vs. Reason is that the value for the source voltage Vs has now distributed or divided itself across the internal resistance Rs and the external load resistance given by RL. By using a bit of algebraic manipulation, we get the load voltage VL, also called as the full load voltage VFL, is equal to Vs divided by 1 plus small Rs upon capital RL. As Rs tends to go towards 0, VL will tend to go more towards Vs. And as RL tends to go towards infinity, open circuit, you'll be having VL approaching the value Vs. Since both the internal resistance and the load resistance are in series, we get the load current IL, it is equal to nothing but the full load current IFL given by Vs divided by small Rs plus capital RL. This is the practical curve which you get for a practical voltage source. This is the curve which you have all seen for an ideal voltage source. The second parameter is nothing but the source or the line regulation. Now this is defined as the change in the output voltage due to changes in the line voltage in the specified range of 230 volts AC plus minus 10% usually taken. Mathematically, it is also defined as the difference between the load voltage with low and high line voltage values. Ideally speaking, the source or the line regulation should be zero, but practically it should be as small as possible, meaning despite the change in the AC lines voltage, the load voltage ideally should not change. Mathematically, the source or the line regulation can be expressed by the following equation. Percentage SR is equal to VLH minus VLL divided by VN. The whole term multiplied by 100, where SR is nothing but the source or the line regulation. VLH is equal to load voltage VL with a high line voltage. VLL is nothing but the load voltage but with a low line voltage. And VN is nothing but the normal load voltage. From this particular figure, we are easily able to see that variations in the AC mains voltage will directly affect the source voltage Vs. But even if Vs changes, the voltage regulator will keep the output or the load voltage VL across the load itself RL almost constant due to the source regulation performance parameter. If SR is close to zero, the changes in the Vs, that is the source voltage, happening due to changes in the 230 volts AC 50 hertz main line will have no direct bearing on the load voltage VL itself. Here we start off with introduction to the Zener diode. Now this particular voltage regulator uses a main component which is called as the Zener diode. The construction is almost similar to the ordinary PN junction diode as we have already seen in module number 1. You have the main body encapsulated in glass or plastic with the semiconductor inside it, and you have two terminals. One is the anode and then one is the cathode. Zener diodes, unlike ordinary PN junction diodes, are typically colorful. Here one can be seen in blue, the other is in red, and one is in typically amber or as well as orange. These diodes are the one which we use in the laboratory. The marker that separates the anode and the cathode is basically identified by a pitch black colored ring which is near to the cathode terminal. So upon identifying this ring portion, it can be easily deduced that the terminal almost adjacent to it is nothing but the cathode, and the terminal exactly opposite to it is called as the anode. On the other hand, Zener diodes can also be available in such packages. So it is extremely important for us to read the part number carefully before interpreting this as a Zener diode or as a normal ordinary PN junction diode. They have the symbol like a typical Z shaped, which helps us to identify that this is a typical Zener diode and it is different compared to an ordinary PN junction diode. So what we see is, from the point of view of the construction, the doping level is kept extremely high as compared to the ordinary PN junction diode during its manufacturing process. The depletion region due to this extremely high doping level is typically very small, usually of the order of less than 1 micrometer. So this shows that how thin the PN junction or how thin the entire depletion layer is. The entire semiconductor material is very, very heavily doped, meaning that it has a huge amount of dopant impurities, giving a large number of pentavalent atoms, while the p-type semiconductor can have a moderate to a high level of doping. The increase in the reverse bias voltage during the normal course of operation will also increase the electric field across the diode, due to which a phenomena called as the Zener breakdown takes place. We will be seeing more about this very soon. Such a carefully controlled and extremely high doping levels can set the reverse breakdown voltage VZ. That is, you are easily able to set the reverse voltage at which the Zener breakdown can take place. Zener diodes, unlike ordinary or normal PN junction diodes, always work in the reverse bias mode during their normal mode of operation. However, ordinary PN junction diodes will always work in the forward bias mode. Again, the symbol to basically represent a typical Zener diode is as again shown. It is almost similar to a PN junction diode. However, this has arrows pointing similar in a Z shape, so that it indicates that the name is nothing but a Zener diode. Now, when we take into account the operation or the working of a Zener diode, let us look at this particular phenomena of something called as the Zener effect. When you guys studied semiconductor physics way back in semester 1, you all studied something called as energy band diagrams. Although the concept of this particular lecture doesn't allow us to go much deep into that, the figure shows the energy band diagrams of a typical PN junction diode under steady state, also called as equilibrium conditions, that exhibit a phenomena called as band bending, according to the laws of semiconductor physics. On the left side, you see a p-type semiconductor. On the right side, you see an n-type semiconductor. EC and EV are nothing but the conduction and the valence bands, while EG represents the forbidden energy gap. Here, as we are all aware, the p-type semiconductor material contains holes as the majority carriers, while the entire semiconductor contains electrons as the majority carriers. Beg your pardon. Minority carriers aren't shown to keep the entire description simple. Under normal conditions, a small change in the external thermal or the ambient temperature might give a bit of energy for the electrons so that they are able to cross this barrier and jump over from N-type to the P-type. This is the normal working of a typical PN junction diode. Now, when a reverse bias voltage is applied, the depletion region width increases because electrons are drawn now more towards the positive battery terminal, while holes are drawn more towards the negative battery terminal. The depletion layer width increases, or the depletion layer area increases. Due to this, again, as per the laws of semiconductor physics, the band bending will increase further as compared to the previous case. Here, you can see that the band bending is slightly intensive. Now, as you increase the reverse bias voltage further, the applied electric field also increases due to the increase in the depletion layer width. And this electric field can be typically as high as 3×10⁷ volts per meter, which imparts enough energy to the electrons, which cause them to now tunnel through or tunnel across the PN junction rather than jump over it. Because the electrons now have sufficient energy. So it's easier for them to just tunnel their way through rather than jumping across the barrier to go from N-type to the P-type region. And as the reverse bias voltage increases further, further and further, the electric field also goes up. This imparts a lot of energy to the electrons, increasing their momentum, increasing their acceleration, and due to which they are easily able to tunnel through the depletion region and cross over to the PN junction, going from the N-type material to the P-type material. This particular tunneling effect increases further, further and further. And this concept is what we call as the Zener effect, in which electrons are actually tunneling through the barrier on account of two things. First thing, the applied reverse bias voltage is very high to establish a large electric field. Secondly, the N-type material already had a lot of free electrons due to the extremely high doping levels. So the Zener effect can only occur in semiconductor devices where the doping levels are extremely high, where you have a lot of free charge carriers such as electrons, which are able to take part in the current conduction process. So when we see the operation or the working of the Zener diode, taking into account the Zener effect, what we observe is, under reverse bias conditions, depletion region width increases since electrons and holes are attracted towards their own terminals. The cathode is given a positive voltage, while the anode is given a negative voltage. Since unlike charges attract, electrons and holes definitely are attracted towards the opposite ends. The increase in the depletion region width will also increase the strength of the electric field across the PN junction. This high electric field gives enough energy to the electrons which are already there, thanks to the very high doping levels in the semiconductor material, to cross over the PN junction by simply tunneling through the region. This generates a large number of charge carriers since the covalent bonds break down easily due to the high energy applied by the electric field. These minority carriers, that is electrons which are generated, suddenly increase the reverse current through the Zener diode. Now, why electrons are considered minority carriers? Because the Zener diode is operating under a reverse bias condition. It is the minority carriers, that is the electrons, which are now responsible for the cause of electric current flowing through the device. This is called as the Zener breakdown phenomena, where there is tunneling of electrons from the valence band straight into the conduction band. This can be graphically shown by a small cartoon or by a small animation as shown. Classical physics is nothing but called as climbing the hill. So under normal conditions, the electrons would have actually jumped over the barrier of the PN junction and gone from one region to the other. But this is called as quantum tunneling, in which the electrons have a very high energy to simply break through and make a tunnel going from one region to the other region. The Zener diode gets its name from the American physicist and scientist Clarence Melvin Zener, who discovered the Zener effect way back around 1929 while doing research on the breakdown in electrical insulators. While doing his course of experiments, he actually discovered the tunneling effect occurring in the semiconductor materials. Once this effect was properly documented, explained, Bell Laboratories, a very big name in the US and the world at that time, which were pioneers in doing research in solid state electronics, they used this property and they constructed diodes, and they aptly named them Zener diodes after him in his honor. Clarence Melvin Zener was a distinguished academician, having passed out from the Stanford University with a bachelor's degree in physics, and he obtained his PhD again in physics from the prestigious Harvard University. His research focused across several domains in physics that had superconductivity, metallurgy, ferromagnetism, diffusion, etc. The Zener diodes are ultimately named after their discoverer, Clarence Melvin Zener. The VI characteristics of a typical Zener diode is slightly different from that of a conventional PN junction diode, because for the conventional PN junction diode, you have the phenomena called as the avalanche breakdown. And here we have a phenomena called as the Zener breakdown. This particular Zener breakdown allows the current through the diode to increase sharply with a very small change or a very small variation in the voltage across it. So, since the Zener diode is always operated in the reverse bias mode of operation, its VI characteristics are always observed in the third quadrant. Here you have the reverse voltage across the diode that is increasing, and you have the reverse current through it, given in terms of milliamperes. Between the ranges of IZ min to IZ max, this is the minimum allowed Zener current to flow, and this is the maximum permissible Zener current which can flow. These two can be controlled by the manufacturer based upon the device geometry, the doping levels, and several other semiconductor physics parameters. So once the Zener current delta IZ is within this range of IZ min to IZ max, the voltage across the Zener diode remains virtually constant in this particular range. This makes Zener diodes very, very useful to maintain a constant voltage across them, which ultimately is the primary need for any voltage regulator circuit. So, looking at the VI-based characteristics, under the reverse bias condition, Zener breakdown takes place at a low reverse voltage due to extremely high doping. The tunneling of free electrons, that is the minority carriers across the junction, will increase the reverse current. At a particular Zener breakdown voltage VZ, which is ultimately decided by the diode geometry, the diode construction, the diode materials, the doping profiles, etc., the current will increase rapidly once the applied reverse bias voltage, that is VR, will increase further. If the current through the Zener diode is between IZ min to IZ max, that is minimum and maximum levels, then the voltage across it will remain almost constant. At a critical point called as the Zener breakdown voltage VZ, the current will increase further only due to the tunneling effect of electrons in the semiconductor material. The forward bias VI characteristics for the Zener diode are exactly similar to that of an ordinary PN junction diode, and hence they are not shown over here. From the reverse biased VI characteristics of the Zener diode, one important parameter of of attention is nothing but the internal resistance of the Zener diode given by the term RZ. This is simply defined as the changes in the Zener voltage across the diode given by delta VZ to the changes in the Zener current flowing through it. Usually, since delta VZ is extremely small, while delta IZ will be now relatively larger compared to delta VZ, the internal Zener diode resistance is also extremely small, typically less than a few ohms. Usually, since delta VZ approaches zero or it is almost constant, RZ will approach zero. There are certain cases in which the internal resistance of the Zener diode is also less than 1 ohms. Practically, the Zener diodes which we use in the laboratory all have a value of RZ typically around a few ohms. So if we just summarize the Zener breakdown principle of operation, we had seen these two figures. They both explain the concept of tunneling. Firstly, the Zener diode has got a huge doping concentration. It has already a large number of impurities present. So it is very easy for such a large number of electrons aggravated by the ever-increasing electric field to establish a tunnel and go on from one material to the other inside the semiconductor device. So what we see is tunneling effect of electrons from the valence band to the conduction band. It occurs only in extremely heavily doped p-n junctions. The high electric field releases a huge amount of free electrons all at once. Now this point is in stark contrast to the avalanche breakdown. In avalanche breakdown occurring for an ordinary p-n junction diode, the increase in the reverse field would cause one or at the max a few covalent bonds to break, releasing electron hole pairs. These electron hole pairs would further break or strike with the electrons of the other covalent bonds, setting up a carrier multiplication or a chain reaction process. However, for the Zener breakdown, this high electric field will actually release a huge amount of free electrons all at once. But for the avalanche breakdown process, this is a step-by-step or a typical chain reaction part. These electrons can easily tunnel through the huge depletion region with due to an increased acceleration and an increased momentum from the electric field itself. Now this goes in stark contrast to the avalanche breakdown, which is what we had seen earlier in module number 1. You have one electron striking the other covalent bond, breaking it, releasing electron hole pairs in the process. And these electron hole pairs further generate several such successive electron hole pairs. So what we have is the carrier multiplication effect, which results in generation of the electron hole pairs. And these occur in light to moderately doped p-n junctions. The high electric field imparts a very high energy, sufficient enough to break the covalent bonds. And with this increased acceleration and the momentum from the electric field itself, these electrons collide with other impurity atoms, producing further electron hole pairs, which again produce further electron hole pairs continuously. So that is the basic difference in avalanche breakdown and Zener breakdown. One slightly off topic to help you understand, giving a very practical example, how a Zener breakdown and an avalanche breakdown can be understood. Consider a classroom in which there are a lot of students present. Now the students are all basically individual elements. They can be somewhat considered to a typical electron. Now, if one of the students or say a small group of students start to murmur or they start to talk, assuming there was a pin drop silence further, this also prompts the other students to start talking. And this so-called talking pandemic will spread in the entire class, but at a slightly slower rate. So the decibel levels of the noise or the sound, they pick up gradually after a point of time where the decibel levels become loud enough because by this time the whole class is actually talking. But if you contrast this to a typical Zener breakdown, this is where the entire class stands up and greets the particular teacher in one voice, good morning or good afternoon, or they all stand in now unison to sing the national anthem all in one go. The decibel levels spike up immediately, almost in an impulsive instant. This is the difference in avalanche and Zener breakdown. Zener breakdown happens instantaneously with the huge influx of electrons due to the high electric field. Avalanche breakdown is a chain reaction process caused by something called as the carrier multiplication. The difference in the Zener and the avalanche breakdown can easily be explained from this particular table. Point number one, avalanche breakdown occurs because of the collisions of electrons inside the p-n junction due to the carrier multiplication effect. But Zener breakdown occurs due to tunneling effect of the electrons from the valence band to the conduction band inside the material. For the avalanche breakdown, the size of the depletion layer is moderately thicker due to it being lightly to moderately doped. However, for a Zener breakdown to occur, the size of the depletion layer is extremely thinner since the doping levels are very, very high. The size can be also less than 1 micrometer. For avalanche breakdown, electron hole pairs, also called EHP, are generated due to the increase in the electric field with the applied reverse voltage. For Zener breakdown, there is a huge influx of the minority carriers, that is the electrons, due to the increase in the electric field with the applied reverse bias voltage. The reverse breakover voltage, beg your pardon, VRBO, for an avalanche breakdown is usually high, typically above 5 volts up to a few kilovolts. Whereas for Zener breakdown, the effect occurs more sooner, usually around 5 to 6 volts. It occurs in p-n junctions with a light to moderate doping levels, whereas Zener breakdown occurs in p-n junctions which have an extremely high doping levels. For avalanche breakdown, ionization mechanism occurs due to the collision of electrons resulting in electron hole pairs. But for the Zener breakdown, ionization mechanism occurs due to the effect of tunneling of the electrons inside the semiconductor material. Avalanche breakdown has a positive temperature coefficient. The diode can be damaged due to the avalanche breakdown. But for Zener breakdown, it has a negative temperature coefficient. And Zener diodes always operate in the reverse bias condition. So even if a Zener breakdown occurs, the diode quickly goes into its original state once the external reverse bias voltage has been removed. With this particular knowledge in mind, let us take the practical example as per the syllabus of the Zener diode as a voltage regulator. A typical voltage regulator is arranged as shown. You have the 230 volts AC 50 Hz mains supply. It is fed to the step-down transformer, the full wave rectifier, and the filter. The output voltage is what we call as the source voltage VS, because this voltage is nothing but the source for the Zener diode voltage regulator. The output is given by VZ equal to VL because this is the voltage across the Zener diode itself. So, a typical voltage regulator that employs the Zener diode contains the entire Zener diode in shunt or in parallel with the load RL, and it will always be operated in the reverse bias condition. When we look at the operation of a Zener diode voltage regulator, two things we have to keep in mind. First thing is, we can have the AC main supply fluctuating, or we can have the load RL also fluctuating. We take the entire operation based on two main points. First thing is, we assume that the load is constant, but the AC mains fluctuates continuously. Secondly, we take a look at the operation in which the AC mains is assumed to be constant, but the load changes continuously. So, looking at the entire block diagram from the circuit point of view, we take the first operation for a varying source voltage VS, but a constant load resistance RL. So this is the entire circuit diagram. You have a very few components. You have over here resistance RS, which is used to limit the current flowing through the Zener diode itself. The load RL is currently what we have. Here it is assumed to be fixed or constant. The load RL is connected in exact parallel or shunt across the Zener diode. Please take a look. The unregulated power supply, that is VS, was obtained from the filter. The load is not connected across the filter, but it is in fact connected towards the end. VS simply represents the fluctuating or the unregulated DC source of the supply voltage, which continuously varies. Zener diode has the current through it given by IZ, and the voltage across it is given by the terms VZ. And since the voltage across the load is given by VL, naturally, looking at the circuit conditions, it becomes very, very clear that VL is equal to VZ. At this particular node, where the Zener diode cathode is, you also have the here confluence of the resistor RS and the load RL. It is at this point where the Kirchhoff's current law can be applied. The current that is entering the node is equal to the current leaving the node. The current that leaves the node is given by IL and IZ, but the current that is entering the node is given by the value IS. So if you apply KCL here, you get IS is exactly equal to IL plus IZ. If we take the first condition of operation, we assume that the source voltage VS increases, possibly due to a surge or due to a transient taking place in the AC main supply of 230 volts AC. So under the first case, we have VS slightly increasing. Once VS increases, then the source current given by IS will also spike, or it will also increase. However, the load current IL remains constant on account of Ohm's law, since IL is equal to VZ upon R. Since VL and VZ are both same, so we get IL is nothing but VL upon R, which is also equal to VZ upon RL. So what happens is, IS has increased due to the increase in VS, but IL simply refuses to budge, or IL will simply refuse to increase. So the additional increment which is happening in IS is allowed to flow through the Zener diode given by IZ. So what we get is the current through the Zener diode IZ increases further due to the KCL equation given by IZ is equal to IS minus IL. And as long as the current through the Zener diode is less than the maximum current carrying capacity, that is, it is less than IZ max, then the load voltage will remain constant thanks to the Zener voltage VZ remaining constant due to the Zener diode reverse bias characteristics. We had already seen the graph earlier. If the Zener current IZ is shuttling between IZ min to IZ max, then VZ will almost remain constant. A similar operation can be obtained if the AC source voltage VS decreases due to a fall in the AC main supply of 230 volts AC 50 Hertz. So if VS falls, IS will also decrease. But as IS decreases, according to Ohm's law, IL will simply not budge, because IL is nothing but VL equal to VZ upon RL. Since IL will not decrease, the Zener diode will make the current passing through itself to decrease on its own due to the KCL equation of IZ is equal to IS minus IL. Here IL is remaining constant, but IS is now decreasing. Hence, to keep the sides balanced, IZ should also decrease. If the decrease in IZ is now already more than the minimum Zener current IZ min, yes, then the voltage across the Zener diode can remain constant at the value VZ due to the Zener diode reverse bias VI characteristics. Finally, we take the last case in which we have the load resistance RL varying due to the practical applications, but here we have the source voltage, that is VS, derived from the step-down transformer, rectifiers and the filters, which is ultimately derived from the 230 volts AC main supply, which is remaining constant here. The component functions are the same. Let us take the first case. Assume that the load RL increases due to the increase in its corresponding ohmic value. Now, since the load RL increases due to Ohm's law, the load current will decrease. But since the source current remains constant, that is because Vs is constant. Once Vs remains constant, it will supply a constant current Is. But since IL has now decreased due to the increase in the load, what happens is the Zener diode current Iz will increase. It will take the excess current from Is into it due to the KCL equation. Iz is equal to Is minus IL. Here Is is remaining constant, but IL is now decreasing due to the increase in the load. So if IL decreases with Is remaining constant, the equation has to be balanced by making Iz increase. But as long as the current through the Zener diode Iz is less than the maximum current, that is Iz max, then the voltage across it Vz will always be equal to the load voltage VL, which will be in turn constant due to the Zener diode reverse bias characteristics. And finally, the similar case is also applicable if the load decreases, due to which the load current will now increase. So once the load current increases, with the source current Is remaining constant again, the Zener diode will cause a decrease in the current flowing through it. So as Iz decreases, but since if Iz is already greater than the minimum Zener diode current required for operation, then we have the voltage across the Zener diode, that is Vz, almost remaining constant, which will again keep the load voltage almost constant. This is due to the property of the Zener diode reverse bias VI characteristics. Thus, we have seen that under both the conditions for varying RL, constant Vs, as well as for varying Vs but constant RL, the Zener diode actually adjust the current flowing through it so that if it is in the range of Iz min to Iz max, then the voltage across the Zener diode given by Vz will almost be constant, giving you a very good voltage regulation. So as we end module number 2, unit number 2.1 about the Zener diode, the list of textbooks, the list of reference books are the same. However, there are a couple of brand new additions for the online websites and for the online resource materials. You have Byju's being the same. You have the same of the, you have the same website of the engineering tutorial, electronic-tutorials. You have a new website called All About Circuits, electronicsnotes.com, electronicsdesk.com, and electronicshub.org. These are a few brand new websites, especially electronicsnotes.com, electronics desk, as well as electronics hub, which give a very good material available to study special semiconductor devices apart from the previously mentioned books. That will be all. Thank you very much.